Just now cut across to the Motilal Oswal Wealth Creation Study that is currently underway in Mumbai.
Mission, because Mini 200 and Mini is the rest of the world. So when you calculate the probability, 3 on 1900 and you feel, God, the world is stacked against me. My belief is actually, apart these numbers that you see, this high ROE, this leadership, this persistence of growth, actually has much more to do with a bunch of other things. It has to do with how organizations are built, what it takes to succeed. And in that, I think, are certain things which are very difficult to crystallize, and like every other place in the world, you know, if you can't measure it, it can't be counted. But I'd venture to say that, in fact, all three as entrepreneurs here, and he's a pretty successful entrepreneur, one thing that makes a huge difference, and you can identify it even in the smallest companies, is a sense of purpose, a mission, a value system, call it what you will. If you find that, and it's a value system that resonates with you and that you believe is something that is laudable, that's the first big way to really try and spot something that goes from whatever it is to mega. And I'll give you three illustrations. 1995, I was privileged, I met Mr. Narayan Murthy. And I was struck by his honesty. Whenever I meet Indian entrepreneurs who believe that honesty above all is an important characteristic of building organizations, I think, you know, I've always been deeply struck by that. Because the conventional belief is in India is, if you want to succeed in business, you have to cut corners. So when I meet people who challenge that belief, to me that's a wonderful sign. In fact, the two other gentlemen here on this dais, and Ramdev himself, are outstanding examples of that. I was privileged to meet Mr. Mariwala in 98 as a young analyst. Exactly the same thing. Tremendous passion and a truly laudable set of values about how you do business. When Godrej Consumer got listed, I was, you know, I don't know whether it was fluke or not, but I was a shareholder. It's a tragedy that I sold too early. But clearly the same story. You know, a family which values, traditions, beliefs in building a business, and the fact that in fact some of their businesses remain unlisted to this day, in some sense is testimony to how they believe those businesses should be grown and developed, which most of us find very difficult to accept. The second thing which I think is very important is again very fuzzy, is culture. Sustaining a culture actually delivers the growth. And let me simplify what culture means. At least my understanding of it, is the way they do things in a company. The way we, you know, the way you conduct yourself day to day in a company. And then there are two other things which are simple, the people you hire and how you develop them. Again, I can't find better examples than the two gentlemen on the dais. I think, in fact, Mr. Mariwala's illustration of this in Marico is, I think it's unsurpassed. In this country, I haven't seen it. A better example, an actual live example of how you do that. And it takes great courage, I must say. And the two other things which I think are very important are innovation. How, in given your business, the circumstances of your business, you manage to do things differently, which help you to grow, which help you to be profitable, which help you to allocate capital sensibly. And again, I think, the Innovation Foundation, I think Mr. Godrej's attempts at, you know, he's a chemical engineer by training, and I think that builds, I think, something in you. But these are clearly, both of them share this as well. And finally, I think something which Ramdev didn't mention, which I think is very essential to get there, I don't know whether they'll agree with me, is luck. You need to have luck on your side. There are some people, and there it's truly admirable, they don't have the best of luck and yet they do incredibly well. I remember there was a very large multinational which used to compete, which competed with Mr. Mariwala. And I think their behavior in terms of trying to cause him difficulties at a point in time when he was still a relatively small company, is not something that people typically associate with multinationals, that particular multinational, and the manner in which he dealt with it and came out of it, I think vindicated all collectively as Marico shareholders our faith that despite what was a very difficult set of circumstances, here is a company that knows how to deal with adversity, because dealing with adversity is essential to success. And when you get, you know, great illustrations of that, you do very well. So I think this is my difference. I think the journey from mini to mega, which is obviously incredibly profitable, is actually a journey we should strive for. So I'm going to deviate slightly from what he said, though I think a lot of takeaways will be common. So I'd like to start by asking Mr. Godrej, you know, of course your group has many wonderful companies, which are true leaders, as Ramdev said. We don't appreciate some of them simply because they're not listed. But Godrej and Boyce, I think, is a truly outstanding company, the bunch of other companies. And the fact that so many international leaders have come to partner with you is suggestive of the fact that you run a wonderful ship. Now, to you, how important is this thing of having a sense of purpose? How much does it drive the way you do business? Is it important? Or do you think if you didn't have as deep-rooted a sense of purpose as appears to be the case to the external observer, it wouldn't make much of a difference?
I think it's extremely important. I think it drives success in many businesses very well.
Mm-hmm.
And a sense of purpose, of course, the definitions can vary, I think is very critical to drive great success and great accomplishment.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there are different ways of going about it. But I think once you define how you are going to do it and you propagate it amongst the people who work
for you,
Yeah. I think it works extremely well.
And that's what creates the culture.
Absolutely.
The translation from mission or purpose to culture.
Absolutely. Right? I think you hit the two very important points that create for success.
These aren't original ideas. These are actually written in a book called What It Takes. So I'm a thief and I must be excused or pardoned for stealing. But I thought it's instructive in the context, since we have, you know, two of you here, to use this. Sir, one thing I'd like to ask you, Bill, as a sort of add-on to what you said. How does someone sitting here in this audience, or let's say analysts or people who interact with Godrej Consumer or the Godrej Group, financial analysts, what are the cues you think they could use to determine that here is a company that is very purposeful, that is driven by a set of beliefs that are very important? How do you do that?
Well,
how do they do that, rather? Not how do you do that. How do they figure this out?
I think we communicate on what we do. For example, in our group, I think one of the things that have helped us tremendously is some of the business processes we have adopted. We use EVA as a major financial metric.
Turns to it, yeah.
Yes, we decided on that many years ago when it was soon after Joel Stern. I met Joel Stern for the first time. It has helped us tremendously as a financial metric that leads to very good success. But most importantly, we have strongly used improvements in EVA in our various businesses across the board for major variable remuneration programs for a large part of our workforce.
Right.
We have some of the largest ratios of variable remuneration to fixed
in
remuneration.
The industry, correct.
That has helped tremendously. Not just as an incentive. One thinks of these sort of things as working very well as an incentive. They do. But it has helped teamwork very considerably, because we have gone for overall performance of a company or a large part of a company in these measurements, and it has led to strong accent on reduction of capital use in
right.
the business.
So what he spoke about, in fact, the point about high quality, consistently sensible capital allocation, in fact, he demonstrated that in spades in Godrej Consumer, as also in Marico. So one other question, and this is a you'll pardon my sort of curiosity, but I'm very interested. What was EDA an accident? You happened to meet Joel Stern, you were very impressed by him, it was a chance meeting and you said, gosh, this is a great idea, I'm going to adopt it? Or was there something sticking in your mind long before you met Joel Stern, which said, one of my priorities as a business leader is to try and come to terms with how I use every single resource that we have in Godrej Company? Is that what drove you to it, or was it a chance meeting? Was it luck?
No, I think it was a very good meeting. I spent a couple of hours meeting Joel Stern, and then he explained how it has been used by other companies, where it
is. So you were very impressed.
It struck me as a very good measure, which could, in fact, solve some of the problems we had.
Right.
So, for example, we had very high return on equity.
Correct.
But we were not growing as fast as
you should. Yeah.
So clearly, to try and have a very high return on equity should not be an objective.
Right.
But having additional businesses which provide a return on capital higher than the cost of capital is extremely important.
Right.
So EVA seemed to be a very good
measure. So the combination of being able to bring it together,
the whole teams right. into that that method of operation,
right.
and has worked very well.
So you actually did something very interesting. You went into an industry which is dominated by multinationals, as he did, and you competed actually with the same guy who was what Ramdev calls the leader in your respective industries. If you think of Godrej Consumer as being very strong in soaps, which it was, I mean, which it dominant business in the beginning when Godrej Consumer first started out, you started similarly in a way. You competed with major, you know, multinational companies, and over time you built an incredibly successful business. What did you set out for yourself as your sense of purpose, as your mission, as your whatever you want to call it? What drove you in the early years, shortly after Marico existed in 96? Because then it was no longer an unlisted company. You had made the transition to being listed.
So I think you're mistaken. We have actually made portfolio choices where we believe we have a right to win, as you had already described earlier. Where we believe that we can be market leaders, you know.
Where
we can become market leaders, a clear market
leader. Where we can become market leaders, okay.
So if you look at our portfolio of products today, in 90% of our total portfolio, we are market leaders.
Right.
So 90% of our sales, we are market leaders. For example, we said that we cannot become leaders in shampoo.
Mm.
But when an opportunity came from Procter & Gamble to sell a small niche shampoo brand, which is anti-lice shampoo, a small market, we said we can become market leader. It's already market leader brand. We knew that the market size was small for the MNCs to enter. So we grabbed that opportunity, acquired the brand. But looking back, I think we fight with MNCs today, almost just 5% of our turnover, we must be fighting with MNCs.
Right,
but when we entered also, you know, we actually entered in categories or segments where we believe that we had a right to win through innovation. And through where the competition was weaker, and so we grabbed a lot of share. And the same thing happened in Bangladesh when we went there.
Right.
The market was 100% local players, and we should have 80% market share in that market.
In a sense, you were looking for markets which weren't that competitive in terms of the presence of very strong players.
One is that, and number two, where you have right to win, where you know or you know a certain
That's
category.
Right. So you can be a leader.
So you can actually have some innovation happening or something in or group of capabilities where you think that if you enter that market, you can actually beat the competition.
Right.
So I think that has been the philosophy. And the key thing in our case is portfolio choice. You know, which is the portfolio you're going to enter? Are you going to become market leader? And now as more and more portfolios are getting occupied, you know, if you have to enter a new product, that's a challenge. So now you said, okay, if not number one, can we be number two?
And the same thinking drove your decision to get into Kaya.
Yes, again, I think we realized that
this
in
is a
skin
big
care, it will be very difficult for us to become market leaders. Can we go through a services route, you know?
Right.
Where there was nobody occupying that space in an organized manner. So we said that can we do it through a services route? So I think that's how we've gone into Kaya Services, which are where we are market leaders again.
And do you think, it appears certainly to all of us, and once again I may have got this wrong, but it certainly seems that even in Marico, there's a very strong and distinct corporate culture, which has had a tremendously positive impact in the wealth creation that has resulted from Marico shareholders. So would you like to just, you know, tell us a little bit about the key elements of that culture?
So that this subject can take almost half an hour for me to speak, but I'll try and sum it up in 5 minutes, you know. I think the key thing is, what are the values which are required, which act as a source of competitive advantage? So you need to identify the right values. But that's the easier part of the culture. You know, you may say innovation, collaboration, openness, trust, whatever else. But after that, how do you create that values into a culture? How do you create a set of behaviors where people go on practicing that value on a daily basis? And that's where the challenge comes in. So the key challenge for the management is, how do you reinforce those values on a perpetual basis?
Right.
So can you create mechanisms where individuals are forced to follow those values on a perpetual basis?
Well, voluntarily choose to do so, not necessarily forced, because they accept the whole thing.
But for example, I'll give you some examples. You know, trust is a value. So we said that from an organizational point of view, what can you do to generate trust? So we said that instead of going to your boss for your expense statement, you can self-authorize it. You will maintain your own leave records. There is nothing like sick leave or casual leave, you know, because if you're sick, you're sick, you know. So we trust you. So I think these are the signals that the organization sends. And then in return, the employees also are, I think, they know that the organization trusts them. The same thing is openness. We're moving into a new office. The brief given to the interior design was, it should reflect openness. Everybody could see each other. We have an open house at all our locations every year, where anybody, including a workman, can ask any awkward questions to management. Then we have teams, the boss and subordinates, they meet once in 2 years and talk about our relationships, you know. Not only with the boss, but at the peer level also. So again, that promotes openness. We send all our managers to a training program, which again promotes openness. So when new openness comes in from different angles, then you build a culture of openness.
And as far as, again, you've been a listed company now, next year will be your 20th year, if I'm not wrong.
96.
Yeah, so 2016 will be your 20th year. It's not a very long period, but it's a journey that certainly has proven thus far for anyone who's been with you an incredibly powerful journey. I mean, I should personally say thank you, because I've been part of that journey. But how do you communicate what you just said about, you know, the things that you do day in and day out to get these incredibly impressive results, so that shareholders can engender the same long-term thinking in the way they own your stock? Is there a way to do that? Because I think if you have patient shareholders who think long-term, sometimes that also helps in building, you know, high-quality businesses.
Yeah. So I would say that there are four or five things, buckets I would put, which are relevant for us to communicate with the shareholder. One is, where is your right to win? Why are you winning in the marketplace?
Okay.
And where are your market leaders? And what are the benefits of becoming a strong market leader in terms of financial returns, you know? And how are you going to be able to sustain your market leadership?
Okay.
So the portfolio choice, market leaderships, right to win is the first most important thing. Number two is growth orientation. Now, we strongly believe that organizations need to grow. If you stop growing, then growth is like oxygen, you know? It satisfies all the stakeholders, so you have to grow. So what are the growth strategies the organization is going to make growth happen? Right. For example, if there is a trade-off between short-term profits and short-term growth, we will go for growth. If from a long-term point of view, if you launch a new product, you will have 5 years before it starts breaking even. In a new country, it could be 7-8 years. For a new business, it could be 10 years. So what signal I'm giving is that, yes, I'm growth-oriented, as long as I'm sure that over a period of time, that leads me to a market leadership position. And once I reach that, I will start getting substantial
benefits of that coming back and getting these.
So I think that's number two.